welcome back to the NBA Show Reviews. This is James Cork, and with me I have Norman Sanso.
Time to play the game!
Of disappearing bears. And awesome Brony reviewer, Silver Quill.
Oh yeah! Step into a Slim Jim.
And rest in peace, Macho Man.
Oh.
Yes, indeed.
You know what? I'm not into wrestling, and even I got sad when they said that Macho Man died.
What about Ultimate Warrior, man? Ultimate Warrior!
That one killed me! That one killed me, too! That was so bad. Oh, my gosh. Oh, well. What do you expect? Wrestling is a tough life.
True.
You know, we're partying in Mardi Gras. There's risks abound in that.
But, as you might imagine, and as you might have been able to tell by the title of this review, we are going to be reviewing a series... oh my gosh, I already started derping out. Issue number 29 of the official My Little Pony Friendship is Magic series, published by IDW, with writing by Ted Anderson, and art by Jay Fosgate, with colors by the always awesome Heather Breckel. Now, this is one issue where I have to admit, I am fairly lost, because I am not all that much into wrestling. But we're going to try and give you our review of it as best as we can. Yes, even I am going to try and give you my opinion on this comic, because what to say about this one that doesn't involve screaming, shouting, roundhouse kicks, and pile drives? So, guys, what did you think of this one comic? What is your opinion of it?
I enjoyed it. This comic was coming after the Root of the Problem arc. And we needed some fun silly. No big bads, no threats against Equestria, just a nice, simple, direct event, which Son of a Gun focuses on Cheer Lee, who I enjoy, but who gets very, very little screen time. Even in episode 100, she was not a big focus. So I was all for the idea that Cheer Lee might get to do something fun. I will say I'm not really big in the world of wrestling. I tried a little in college, but I never inhaled.
And, okay.
And I see why people might enjoy it, but ultimately you got to watch it with a group. It's the group energy that drives wrestling forward. And once you take that away, it becomes kind of ho-hum. We'll get into the specifics, but...
Oh, yeah, because actually, like, almost all good wrestling matches, there's a couple of twists going on here and there.
Yeah.
But the twists!
There's more to it than meets the eye.
Yeah, true. I don't know. I mean, for me, with this one, I don't know what I was expecting, really. I mean, wrestling, ponies, you would have never thought that to be real. I mean, obviously, we had a lot of pony fightings and whatnot, so that's cool. But for them to do like a wrestling event, like pro wrestling, that's something, well, new and strange. And for Cheerlee to be the main star for this one, wow, who would have thought?
So, is that you with your thoughts, Norman?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for now.
So, to me, I am a complete outsider when it comes to this. Like, I know how wrestling works and all that. It's like, it's modern gladiators. It's soap opera for men. It's all pretend, but it isn't. But it is. But maybe it isn't. But no, really, it's all pretend. But it's a very entertaining business. And how are they going to use this to the advantage of telling them the story, presenting the characters, and making it interesting? Even for people who know next to nothing about wrestling, they actually managed to pull it off really well. Like, there wasn't a moment in the comic where I was like, I'm lost, I don't know what's going on, I don't know what's happening. They do a very good job as using wrestling as a background for the whole thing, while keeping it focused on the relationship between Cheerlee and her sister, and everything that is around them. And it's funny how they are able to throw a parallelism with my favorite of the Friends Forever comics, the Rainbow Dash and Spitfire one, which oddly enough is done by the same team who did this one. So it's pretty good. It's very interesting, and I actually enjoyed it. I found myself rereading it more often than not, which is surprising. So yeah, personally, I really enjoy this comic a lot. But let's not get ahead of ourselves, and let's talk about it. So we're gonna go hip deep into spoilers. If you guys don't want to get it spoiled, go give it a read, and then come back, listen to us. Okay, so now into spoiler territory. How would you guys want to tackle this one? Shall we go story order, or shall we do what we did last time and focus on the themes? Which I think it's the course of action that fits better for this kind of review, you know?
Well, I recommend starting with a cross-eyed chop, followed by a pile driver. Go for the pin, but they'll probably kick out.
Yeah, and then don't forget the interference from the outside. Like, you need that. Yeah. It builds drama,
but then once you jump off the turnbuckle and put them through the tables and chairs, that's it, Devon.
Yep.
Woo, look at that! The sky is so full of wrestling references that I am sorely not getting. It's amazing! Look at all those! Bye! Yeah, I cannot follow on that.
We are good co-hosts.
Yay!
Yeah, you're the best.
I think a flow of events works very well with this comic.
Yeah, I think that works too, because if we go by theme, that won't work, because the theme for this one is wrestling. You don't know wrestling. And if we were to focus on wrestling, it'd be detracting from the real theme, which is family. So, yeah.
Family. I think the theme in this is enjoyment.
That too.
Because that's apparent on the very first panel. And those 1,000-yard stares of all those ponies. Ye gads. If I had a stadium full of those things looking at me, my soul would shatter.
Oh, then you don't know Daniel Bryan then.
The theme is that heroism and actually role models as well. I'd say those are the themes. But you're right. Let's go with a series of events. That's probably the best idea. So We start right away on the one of those wrestling competition championships where the main six are watching the main event and all that, and Rarity is getting bored, which it's funny the way that she starts. She's getting bored of it and she walks away, only to find that Cheerilee is also watching the match, which is very funny considering that the one wrestling on the arena or on the wrestling square, or whatever you call it, is Chidley's sister.
The mystery mare.
I do like how they've approached this one, because at first, Chidley's trying to lie her way out of this, but, you know, she just gave up and just tell the truth, because that clears out a lot of scenarios, or a lot of, whatchamacallit, not needed type of stories.
Oh, filibuster, pork, excess.
Yeah, I don't know. Is the words there?
Rush Limbaugh.
Yeah, probably. it removes a lot of excess baggage. In my opinion. So yeah, drop that aside. We know that Charlie's sister is in the ring. Okay, good. Now we don't have the whole scenario of, oh, you look like the teacher in Ponyville. Oh, this is my sister. Oh, why didn't you? We remove all that. Now we just go to the meat of the story.
Yes, but I do want to backtrack just a sec. To appreciate the full artwork of this comic, all you have to do is look at that last panel on the first page. If you do not find this adorable, I urge you to check for a pulse.
Oh, yeah. Like, the artwork by, who again?
Jay Foskey.
Has been always nice. It's cool. It's really interesting. It works well for the ponies. And for her to do an action scene, that's cool.
You know, is that the way sometimes it works with some artists is that the artwork, it adds to the likability of the characters. With Jay Foskey's artwork, the characters are always like likable on the way, like on the get-go. They are like, oh my god, they're so cute. Oh my god, they're so nice. Oh my god, they're so great. And there they go to beat the ever-loving crap out of each other.
Like good ponies do.
It's brilliant. Like we follow in from the theme that ponies do like roller derbies. So yes. Now they also like wrestling. These cute little horses, they love the violence.
True. Then what next?
I love it. I absolutely love it.
We got wrestling, we got roller derby. Then what? Mm-hmm. It's going to be equestrian gladiators?
It's going to be equestrian racy, where everyone just watches for the crashes.
Mare's car.
Oh, no.
And it will be like the real origins of NASCAR, with all those bootlegged alcohol-driving drunkards escaping from the law. You know that that's how NASCAR started, right?
I got no idea, man.
I wouldn't doubt it. Now we invite the drunkards to watch.
But
sorry,
yeah,
NASCAR fans.
Let's not get ahead of ourselves. And I'm pretty sure we're gonna have a comic about NASCAR one of these days, and it's gonna be awesome.
Probably.
But definitely Chili and her sister, they don't look eye to eye. They don't have the best of the relationships, and so Rarity decides to help. Right? She's the one who says, "Oh no, let's set up like a breakfast or a meal or something, and we can all meet up and talk to each other." And that's where we see that Shirley and her sister don't really have the best of relationships. They kind of like are very angry at each other. They are very much twins, except for the hairstyle. They even have a similar name, Cherry and Cheery. Now that would be confusing when they were growing up.
Well, not really, because if one is from Nippon, one would call her Sakura.
Oh God, why Sakura?
Because cherry blossom is a direct translation.
Oh, I get it.
Then it's up to Cheerilee to capture all the mystic cards.
Yay!
With the help of her friend Derpy. No.
Yeah.
Now, can I just say that Cheerilee is cold-blooded?
Oh,
because,
yeah.
Because in the background, as she's talking to Rarity, good Lord, that is not a wrestling match. That is a full-on brawl. There is smoke. There are stars. I'm sure we should see some Adam West pow, zap,
pow,
splat.
Yeah, but that's the most convenient way to draw a fight scene. Draw clowns.
That's just it, though. Wrestling is, in truth, a very stylized, choreographed dance, as it were.
I would say dance. I would just say fight scene.
Oh, well, that's why you have to practice.
Oh, yeah.
Well, we say fight scene, but the goal, ironically, is that people not get hurt.
Oh, yeah, that's true. But, you know, in movie fight scene, it looks real, but it's not. But, hey, in wrestling, the goal is the same, but sometimes you botch, and that's where the fun is.
I've seen some botches. You get hurt. I don't know. People say, oh, wrestling's fake. It's scripted. But you're still taking risks.
Oh, yeah, that is true.
So many broken necks.
Oh, that is also true.
Careers ended. Mm-hmm. Lives lost in a few cases.
Yep.
But heroes are born from this.
Heroes are born. Oh, the Undertaker is the end of his streak at WrestleMania.
Oh, and the versus Lesnar. Ay, ay, ay. Everybody was shocked. The stadium was quiet.
Yes, and hold on to that memory because that'll come into play later on in this comic.
Ooh. I wonder how.
Basically, but we get to the tea scene where, again, the ponies are in full adorableness.
Yay.
And now that nobody can argue that they can be as cute and cozy and tea partying as they can while also having something so macho and violent in the comic. So it's like, yeah, you can combine both perfectly. That is the beauty of Generation 4. G1, it will be just the tea party. Only the tea party. And that's it.
Hey, not really. There's also death and gloom and blind ponies getting their eyes restored with crystals.
Oh, yes. That was G1 as well. Mm-hmm. But it happened to humans, not ponies.
Oh, wow. Well,
yeah,
that's dark.
Let's not. Let's not.
Applejack's a psycho killer.
Call me silly one more time.
She's the one with the basement.
No. Carry on, James, before we sidetracked to another Grimdark story.
Me, carry on. No, I'm not good with this reviewing thing.
Then I have a question. What do you think happened to drive these sisters apart? Because Cheerilee, even though she was very upset about making a good first impression or trying to mend fences, the minute she walks into the room, she's like, Cherry.
Hello, Cherry.
I think there's a lot of variables here. It could be from sibling rivalry, mixed personalities, years of abuse. I don't know. There could be a lot of factors in their mismatch of personalities. It's hard for me to say. It could be many of them. I'm sure that our listeners here may have relatives or sisters or brothers that they don't mix well or they don't mingle well.
Usually when you have a family feud or when you have a problem with one of your relatives, it goes way too deep because the relationship is stronger just for the sake of like blood bonds happening and all that. So when there is a fallout between a brother and another, between brothers or siblings, it's usually a very touchy subject that nobody wants to get into because that only concerns the both of them. Mm-hmm. So I am not sure if they bring it up throughout the comic, but the fact that they don't actually talk about why Cherry and Cheerilee don't talk to each other anymore or why they are angry or uppity with each other anymore, with each other so much, I think it's better to leave it like that. It adds to the mystique of the whole thing. Yeah, and you don't really need to explain it. Because, well, let's be honest, we all have had moments where we don't want to talk to like our parents, our brothers, or our cousins. Hell, if I know, that happened to me a couple of times. So, I think that not explaining it makes the characters more interesting. Like, it adds the what happened factor to it.
But it gives me room to make headcanons.
Here we go.
Once there was a stallion who both sisters coveted.
Oh, yeah, that's also a factor, too.
He chose one sister, but the other, unwilling to be denied, pretended to be her twin.
They are twins.
Yes. But she pretended to be that actual twin.
Oh.
And then he was discovered. There was drama. There was arguing. And then the stallion said, I must go. My home planet needs me. And then he jumped into his spaceship, but got hit by a meteor. And then there was a mariachi band. And that was just weird.
What? I'm just confused right now.
It wasn't weird until the mariachi band came in.
And yeah. that's your average film fiction story.
Yeah, I think this is where Cherry bolted because she didn't want to be in the same room with Cherry.
But it's a curiosity, so I'm just wondering what happened. What could drive them apart?
Oh, it could be either the worst of things or the simplest of things. It could go from you stole my boyfriend from me to you stole my eraser from me. It could be any number of circumstances. Yeah. You may never know.
Yeah, and also, I think they did touch upon the why, but it was not fleshed out. So, yeah, more headcanons to be built there.
So, I guess the question then is, should we talk about how a Cherry gets popped?
yes, please. Let's talk about Cherry being popped.
Oh, no.
In the knee.
Oh.
Right in the knee, which it's actually when you're reading this and all that, it of course surprise later on, but it's funny how this badass wrestling fighter gets knocked out by a single step.
Yeah, for those at home who are wondering what happened, Cherry accidentally slipped and sprained her ankle, I think.
Yeah, Cherry left as she was leaving the party, and Cherry was apologetic. She was like, no, please don't go. I don't want it to end like this again. I want to apologize. I want to fix things. And as she's running after Cheerilee, she falls off a step and hurts her ankle, her knee, her leg or something. So, of course, as it makes sense, they send her to the glue factory. I mean, no, they send her to hospital. only for her to find out that she is going to be in bed for 6 weeks when the championship is in 3 days. And there is no other way to solve this rather than, hey, Shirley, you look a lot like me. You should be Mystery Mare.
What an unbelievable coincidence.
What a twist.
This is so convenient.
Yeah.
I actually really like this type of stories. The ones that is like the twin has to take place, the place of the original, in order to pull out, in order for the plot to continue.
Oh, yeah.
I like how they do it in this one, is that Chirilly is not accepting right away, but not because she doesn't like her sister or anything, but because she's terrified of wrestling.
She straight out says no. She didn't even get
yeah,
an answer.
She's like,
she just
I don't know
ran.
How to wrestle. I'm a teacher. I don't know how to do it. I'm sorry. And then she runs away.
Yeah.
Yeah, but in the next panel, Rarity goes after her and she's crying her eyes out.
That's called family there, because she really wants to help, but she's afraid of getting hurt. Now, I bring this up to you guys and also the listeners at home. How does one become a teacher and the other became a wrestler?
Well, I am an artist and my sister is learning to be a biologist.
Yeah, okay.
My father is an economist. One of his brothers is an architect. The other one I think it's a builder. Mm-hmm. And their father, my grandfather, he used to be in the army. Yeah. So, like, we do have that difference between, like, what, you think that the entire family should be teachers? Or the entire family should be lawyers? Oh my god, an entire family of lawyers, that would be awful.
You stole my razor, I'll sue you. No, but no.
Can you imagine? No!
Well, my point is, for some pony, like Cherry to become a wrestler, what influenced her? That's something to think about.
My father was a lawyer.
Are you for
my
real?
My father was a lawyer.
Yes, he's been a lawyer all my life.
oh my god, I'm so sorry.
My brother is a copywriter. I have been a video editor, a paralegal, and now a graphic artist.
Wow.
Awesome. So, you know, family life is winding, and we often the passions we pursue, I don't believe it's totally genetic based.
Mm-hmm. And this brings up the saying of the cutie mark. So I'm not going to go there. Last episode we talked about
cutie
marks.
Can I take a moment from the review and just say that I apologize for the lawyer joke?
Oh, are you kidding? Do you know how many lawyer jokes we make?
I'm pretty sure you do, but that doesn't give me the right.
Oh no.
Starts with oh, society and start with the lawyers.
back to the comic.
I do just want to say this. My dad, when people ask him what he wants to do, like on a plane ride or something, and he just doesn't want to talk to him, mm-hmm. he just says he's a gynecologist, and that's the end of the conversation.
But
I got to work with a bunch of.
That's not a word.
Oh, a proctologist and gynecologist. Depends on what.
Oh, God. I don't know how to censor that one.
You don't have to, man. I'm using medical terminology.
I'm sure CityBot will do something about it. But anywho, back to the comics.
Yeah, we were reviewing a comic here, remember?
Yeah.
But now we're talking about proctologists.
Them plots. Well, we were going to talk about plots anyway, so makes sense. So Rarity, who, by the way, love the involvement that Rarity has in this whole comic, and she's going to get even more involved as the story progresses. She's the one who managed to talk Chirilly into helping her sister with the wrestling match and all that. And we instantly cut to the scene where they are prepping for the match and all that. And I am very glad that they are showing this kind of preparation and how they train and all that. And how everything is one big theater. Everything is a one big preparation, and that there is not really that big of a rivalry, at least, but that it's all pretend. It's all made for the sheer spectacle and showmanship.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's something that real life wrestling tries to cultivate. In the ring, they are all getting each other's faces, betraying one another, you know, having these huge rivalries. You get off the stage and they're all just having a laugh and shaking hands at the hammy performances.
That's partly true, but I'm not going to go in depth to behind the scenes wrestling, but what you guys says is true, and part of it is not true at the same time, so give and take. But if you guys notice, like, every time when there's a WrestleMania at every location, the wrestlers go on TV or they go to some charity event or some meet and greet, they're just cool guys, just hanging out in the public and whatnot, talking to each other, drinking a few cold ones and whatnot.
No, that's not to say they're all best buds. I'm sure there's the usual backstage drama between personalities. Yeah. That's life.
Yeah, that's true.
But it's nothing like what they try to do in the ring.
Mm-hmm. However, and I am going to take this just for a moment, we can safely say that this comic has better research and a better presentation of what modern gladiator fights are than many other Hollywood movies with higher budgets. And I'm giving my stink eye to that gladiator film.
Or, heck, this is doing a better job than Scooby-Doo at WrestleMania.
Oh, that one. But that one is just for entertainment's sake. And it's cartoon, so they can do whatever they want.
And yeah, but this is cartoon as well.
I wouldn't be entertained.
I need to watch that.
This is a cartoon as well, and still it has a better representation of the sport than others are willing to show. This one at least takes its time to build up for the big fight, and it makes sense, and it develops character. It is wonderful to see Cheerilee and her sister working together. Mm-hmm. And now that we are going to see Cheerilee trying new different moves and all that, we should take a moment to talk about the different costumes and the outfits that the characters have. Because what lovely work they did with the costumes in this comic. I think they are one of the highlights. How each costume is distinctive. You don't get lost seeing who is who or who is fighting who. Mm-hmm. And it's pretty much like that with real wrestling matches now, isn't it?
Depends. Most of the wrestlers nowadays go by black trunks, boot, and elbow pads, and they just hit each other. One's with long hair, the other's bald. It depends on who you're looking at. But the one that we're looking here with Cheerilee's costume is more akin to Lucha Libre.
Yeah, almost all the wrestlers are masked, which is... Yeah, I'd go with the... I'm getting the luchador vibe. But some of the more famous wrestlers are, you know, now wearing blue jeans in the ring.
Oh, yeah.
John Cena comes to mind.
Why are you laughing, Norman?
Because he knows who I'm talking about.
Yes.
Oddly enough, I know John Cena as well. I wasn't expecting you to giggle.
That's a reference you were right there. He said something I know!
And I get lost on it. But as they are training, making very good use of the panel borders, by the way. Let me look at page 13. One of the panels, the poor guy just gets pinballed left and right because of the panels. And during this many training, after training so much, Cheerilee suddenly gets challenged by an unknown wrestler called Ironhawk, who happens to be the arch rival of the Mystery Mare.
Mm-hmm. Oh, before you glance over that, we have a cute scene with Rarity and Cheerilee, where Rarity is carrying her home to the hotel or whatever, and this is where Cheerilee remembers how Cheerilee and Cherry interact when they were younger.
So there might be a little bit of information about their sister relationship. One energetic, one shy.
Yeah, basically they were incompatible when it came to personalities.
Mm-hmm. Also, it appears that Cherry was trying to eat Cheerilee's head. Yes.
Who does that?
Nom, 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 nom.
She's a mind parasite. Quick, use some cold on it. It's the only way to keep them at bay.
But yeah, focusing on arch rival. Who was it again? Ironhawk?
Ironhawk is the arch rival and the opponent of Cheerilee in the match for the championship. Mm-hmm. In the title match. And it's, I guess this is like for the theatrical and all that, for the audience, but it is a bit weird that it's happening in the locker room.
No, it's
like, why would they be doing that? No, I mean, why putting up a show? Wink, wink, nudge, nudge.
Yeah, like sometimes when I said before, sometimes the wrestlers, they don't mix well, they don't mingle too well, so you have some, whatchamacallit, difference of opinion, and they don't like each other. And apparently, Iron Hawk is one of those ponies that don't like Mystery Mare, and it goes beyond the ring.
Yes, I'm so sure it does. Wink, wink.
Yeah, I don't really get it because the foreshadowing is too subtle.
I'm trying to play clean, yo.
There's this neon sign. Guess who this is? Guess who this is?
Hey, technically, I didn't know it first. But anyway, let's carry on.
You know what? Let's be fair. I didn't know it either. I didn't know who it was either. I didn't put one and one together because, okay, we're not gonna give away who's the mystery wrestler. But the way that this guy looks, we didn't see much of him before or after the fight, so we don't know who this could be yet. Mm-hmm. But it only puts Cheerilee into a lot more pressure, which shows on the next day, right before the match and all that. And here we go again with Rarity being like the best friend of friends. Like, my God, this comic is worth reading just for the Rarity moments alone.
Oh, yeah.
She's at her best, at some of her best. In this comic, she is as supportive and kind as she was in the Philly Vanilli episode.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Being so good and so kind to her friend. When she doesn't really need to, because, well, you know, Cheerilee is not part of the main six clique, yet Rarity dedicates her as much time as she thinks it's needed. Mm-hmm. Which is awesome. I mean, best horse being best horse.
Rarity has always been supporting character when it comes to helping friends out, no matter if they're in the clique or not. And yeah, Rarity's always been, like you said, best horse for that kind of situation. And is it me, or is Rarity's mane flowing rather elegantly this time?
It's a bit Celestia-ish in its way.
Yeah.
It's the way that Jay Fosgate draws the mane, which I think it looks gorgeous on her.
I know. It looks good.
Looks really good.
I know.
The great humor in all this is Rarity was the one least entertained by wrestling at the first page.
Mm-hmm. But I think now it's kind of different because she's more invested in helping her friend than the game or the
She's
match.
Able to put, she's able to put all of that behind her just for the sake of helping Cheerilee.
Mm-hmm.
So even if the comic is not about Rarity, Rarity has her own character arc going on.
Mm-hmm.
Which is just great. I mean, this is, I'm sorry, I could be gushing because I like the way that this is written.
Yeah, but this is also another characteristic that's been carried over by Rarity from the Friends Forever series with Beb Seeds.
Where again, she got involved in a sport she wasn't really into for the sake of another.
Mm-hmm. I see this is kind of a progression, so this is good.
Yeah, this is a very important step forward.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Let's just hope it carries over on the show.
But in the here and the now.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, yes. So right after Rarity comes around, and she's like, come here, I'm going to show you something that is going to cheer you up. Put on the mask. And she's presented with all the kids that are big fans of the Mystery Mare. And that's where she finds out, that what she does and what her sister does are not all that different because they do have the same effect. I mean, say what you want about grown-ups liking wrestling and all that, usually the biggest fans of wrestling are the kids. They are the ones who like to see these big hulks of guys just beating the hell out of each other. And they have they support their heroes and they boo for the villains and they are happy. And at least in this universe, in the MLP universe, the wrestlers do make them Phyllis and Colts happy, which is what Cheerily does for her daily job. I mean, it's not just teaching the kids, but also keeping them happy and looking after them, being a good role model for them.
Mm-hmm. And that's why I brought up The Undertaker and his run at WrestleMania.
Ooh, that.
The wrestling industry prides itself on the connection it forges with its audience, you know, to get them to boo, to cheer, to get them invested, to drive Spoonie to copious amounts of drinking and loud tirades.
Let's not talk about Spoonie and his very piss poor way of selling wrestling as something entertaining.
But at WrestleMania, for those not knowing, The Undertaker had like a 26-win run at WrestleMania. It was his event, but as he was getting older, it was getting time for him to settle, you know, to step back. Mm-hmm. The most recent WrestleMania, he lost for the first time.
That was last year, actually, the recent one
Last year. Yeah. Oh, he did it again? Wow. I've been a little out of touch. But there was complete silence as people saw that 26-1 come up on screen. And I question the writing in wrestling because it always seems to accentuate the worst of people in my eyes. You know, the betrayers win, the greedy succeed. But people always hope and root for the heroes. The greedy and the scheming and the cheating is there to make the other guys look that much better. You want them to win. So when The Undertaker stumbled back, he had a concussion. When he walked back off stage, people cheered for him. It wasn't about that he lost. It's that we're proud of you for coming this far. And that's the connection that wrestling forges with its audience.
Yeah, that's the thing with certain wrestlers, like the same WrestleMania that you're talking about. There was a wrestler called Daniel Bryan. He was kind of the underdog. People or the company didn't like him. He was, how do I put this? When you think of wrestling, you think of Dwayne The Rock Johnson. You think of Stone Cold, Triple H, and also Undertaker. You don't think
Hulk
about,
Hogan.
Yeah, Hulk Hogan also. And you don't think about the skinny, well, short guy, bearded face guy with the trunks and whatnot. You don't think him as a wrestler. But this guy has a personality, his persona, his attraction is beyond normal, that he attracts a lot of fans saying or giving him support. And him going through what he went through and winning at the end, the stadium of, I think, about over 10,000 people was cheering on for him, saying his catchphrase, yes, yes, yes. And that was said over and over and over again.
And from a non-wrestling fan perspective, it's just, you know, covering all the angles. I mean, from a non-wrestling fan perspective, this is a really good moment for the character of Chili to find out that her talent is not exclusive, the one that brings happiness to others, is that her sister is also doing something great. And that's the point where almost all of her fears dissipate and she just jumps to the match. She's like, yeah, I'm going to do this. I'm going to take care of this. I'm going to kick the crap out of Iron Hawk. I think it's a good moment for the character, even better moment for the writing. And I like that. I think it's great.
All right, so the match begins.
Bing, bing, bing.
And it's funny, while we complained about Root of the Problem with its one-page fight scene, rather one-sided, we get like 3 pages of Cheerily getting thrown to the mat 5 different ways.
Well, it is wrestling. But by the way, before we carry on, I need to know, at Ironhawk's site, are those references to some pony or somebody in real life?
Well, the dude with the beard and the hat, I don't know if that's meant to be Rocky Balboa's trainer. You can't do it, Rock.
Hmm. I don't think that's Mickey. I don't think that's Mickey. Mickey never had a beard.
Mickey's been shown in the show as Spitfire's trainer.
Really?
Something similar to it.
I don't remember. Well, I don't remember that. But the mayor, I'm definitely getting that vibe. Like, you know, it's someone's OC, but you don't know who.
It's Amy Winehouse.
Oh no.
Even worse is Kim Kardashian. I don't know. It looks like a celebrity, kind of like cameo or a pony fight, important person or something like that. It does look too distinctive to not to just be a throwaway design.
Yeah, the two of them to be exact. But anyway, we have a fight and Shirley or Mystery Mare is having a one-on-one with Ironhawk. I wish I knew how to spin this off or how to call the match, but I got no idea.
No, but I like the fact that they actually take the time to build a fight. I mean, it's better than just, well, it's going to contrast later on, but for this one actually is a personal victory for Shirley. Because this is her taking it on her own and just doing her own thing. I think it works super well. Especially considering how well shot it is. Well, how well shot, how well drawn it is. That the action is clear to see and you know what's going on in each one of the panels. I know that's like the basics of any comic, but holy crap, there are so many superhero comics where most of the times I am looking at the panels trying to decipher what the hell is going on. So the movements are clean, the lines are clean, and you don't get lost on the action.
Yeah, in this one you know what's going on in every scene, like Shirley's jumps, Iron Hawk dodge, Shirley falls on back. So
Hulk smash.
Yeah, I mean,
sorry, it worked going that way. It was impossible for me not to do that.
Yeah, but everything is coherent. Like you can even see the ref who is on standby to count. So yeah.
Yeah, Michael Bay, take note.
Good thing he's never going to direct a My Little Pony movie. Oh no, I jinxed it now.
Oh no.
Coming in 2018, My Little Splosions.
But yeah, the wrestling match is very intense, goes on for 3 pages, but never overstays its welcome. And they end up crowning Shirley as the winner until the second part of the match goes on, which is the tag team match.
Tag what
Boo.
Now?
Tag
Boo.
Team.
Yeah, I just love that expression on Shirley as she hears tag what now?
Tag what now?
Plus that clomp 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 is one letter away from being inappropriate.
Oh no. Not again, not again.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Sir, I abhor you.
No, not again, not again.
Well, this is to the invited Anderson. What did you expect?
But yo, this scene where after the tag team match now, like the introduction of Shirley's partner. Oh God,
Diamante Elegante.
That is. You see that it works so well because the previous match was really, really intense, really hardcore, and it went on for 3 pages. This one you just need to have Rarity going, let's wrestle, darlings. But they win!
And she really is like, what? I like the audience, we're just, what?
And I'm here sitting down thinking there's not been enough fun out of Rarity in a skin-tight spandex wrestling suit. I need to fix this.
I just need to ask. She got that on standby? What?
This is rare. Well, you know, make that on standby.
Yeah, she could. She doesn't need to think to get that outfit going. Come on.
But this one panel victory, we've been complaining about comics not doing a good job at fight scenes, but like you said, James, wrestle, win. Cheerly says what? Enough. You use your imagination. Fanfic writers, comic drawers, do your job.
So they win. They manage to get the title belt. They win the championship and all that. Pinkie Pie is trying to wrestle with Applejack, and Applejack is doing a very bad job at it.
Just because Pinkie Pie is physically assaulting her friends.
It's so cute.
I know.
And the relationship between Chirley and her sister is fixed.
Yeah.
And it turns out that Cloverleaf was Ironhawk.
Dun, 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 dun.
Dun, dun, dun. And yes, I agree. I admit, I didn't see that coming.
Same here.
Completely caught me off guard. And it makes perfect sense.
Same here.
It does, but at the same time, then it raises the question. If this was obviously scripted. Cloverleaf was in on the match. Why she felt the need to intimidate Cheerly, I'm not sure.
Well, just because for drama's sake, I don't know. I mean, it does. Okay, when you say it brings up a plot hole, I don't know how much of wrestling is scripted beyond what the wrestlers know. Sometimes wrestlers need to improvise in ring. So let's
assume that all of wrestling is scripted.
Then, yeah, including who wins.
Yeah, that's also true.
So. Truthfully, there may never have been any tension that Cheerly was going to win, just her lack of confidence. Mm-hmm. But even if you go with that approach, I still think this comic holds up because it's more about mending the gap between sisters.
Mm-hmm. That is true. I do support that. And, well, in the end, the main issue was solved by the end, because the point for Cheerly going to the ring or going to the wrestling match was to mend relations with Cherry, but because of egos or something else, I got no idea, they kept on fighting. And because of this whole event, they got back together.
And Applejack now has a concussion.
Oh, God.
I'm glad that they covered the violence with the end banner right there.
Yeah. Oh, no, that's them covering up an on-screen mortality. They had to get They had to get Applejack's twin cousin herself to cover the rest of the series because Pinkie Pie killed Applejack. There you go.
Yeah.
But there you go. There's your comic, kids.
Wow, darkness. All the kids crying.
I just love Twilight Stein. When did you make that mess? It never hurts to be prepared, dear. Like, what?
Maybe Rarity's come to embrace the weirdness of her life. It's like, I don't really like wrestling, but somehow I'm going to end up on that stage. Might as well get ready.
Yep. But overall, this comic is not bad. I like it.
It's fun.
I like how you start saying this comic is not bad. And I'm like, okay. That's a nice way to put it.
It's okay, here's the thing. It's a wrestling match. It's all about wrestling. So people might get turned off by the whole idea of, oh, wrestling, I hate wrestling, I don't want to do anything with wrestling. But as far as we review, the wrestling part is just us derping around, talking about wrestling. Nothing more than that.
Or it's just the backdrop. And thankfully, any story can connect if you throw in good characters.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
One of the reasons I don't stick with wrestling is that, truthfully, I don't really identify with a lot of the characters in wrestling.
Hmm.
Now, when my friends and I watched it in college, you know, it was the group energy. And that's what this really relies on, a stadium full of fans cheering.
True, true.
Which, not surprising, is in the comic as well.
Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Okay, so shall we give our final thoughts, the conclusion to what we thought of it?
Yeah, sure.
Well, like always, inverted alphabetical order, why change what ain't broke, right? Let's go for it.
Alrighty. Well, I will say that this is a fun, enjoyable comic. It's lighthearted when we especially needed it to be so. And so I'd recommend it just for a fun read with a little bit of silliness and maybe a little bit of that wrestling cheese.
Yeah, I agree with that. I totally agree with that.
And while the ending may steal some of the dramatic tension, you realize, it was never really about that anyway.
As for me, how do I put this? I like everything about this comic, the art, the story, the pacing, especially the pacing. The pacing is done quite well. And how do I put this? The lesson here or the moral works. I don't find any negative in this one. I am happy with my purchase with this one. And looking at Rarity and her outfit, that was like, okay, that happened.
I'll hit that. No.
Uh-huh.
Yes, no, a lot. No, uh-huh. No.
I'm sure there's many fans going, swing!
Swing!
Because for some reason, in defiance of modern real world, where we want less clothing, here we apparently want more. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That makes total sense.
Indeed. What about you, James?
Well, this is, how to word my thoughts on this one? It left me wanting more. This comic left me wanting more. I wanted to see more outfits. I wanted to see more wrestlers. I wanted to see more fights. I wanted to see more character. So I guess a comic that leaves me wanting more, it's a good comic.
Mm-hmm.
So I hope that in the future we go back to this kind of scenario. I hope we have a spin-off or an alternate series or something dedicated to this kind of sport. Or maybe having an entire month dedicated to just sports. Like, I don't know, we can have an entire one issue for roller derby, one for wrestling, one for basketball, another one for rugby. And I say rugby, not American football. I'm talking about real football, god damn it. and I don't know. It is very fun. It is very enjoyable. And it is very likable. Which, coming from the same guys who did the Spitfire and Rainbow Dash Friends Forever comic, I think that's a given.
Yeah.
They are very good when it comes to characters. This one is a bit of a step down.
Really?
I think this is not as good as the Friends Forever with Rainbow Dash and Spitfire, even though it could very much play like one, because it's a single issue, it follows Chirly and her sister and Rarity, which what a weird pairing, by the way, but it is a very fun, very enjoyable, very innocent, it's a very innocent, very naive comic, but for all the right reasons. Is that it doesn't focus on the bad parts of the wrestling world, and it actually shows you a very positive in a very positive light what people find appealing about wrestling. I will put it this way: this comic made me want to watch wrestling, as opposed to the tens of dozens of videos that Spoonie has made in the past, where all he does is just say how wrestling is the worst thing in the world. So just to have someone say, hey, this is why wrestling is enjoyable, it makes me want to go, yeah, you know what? I want to watch a couple of episodes now. I want to watch a couple of shows. Hell, there is a couple of YouTubers who do live streams of wrestling every now and then on Thursdays.
Mm-hmm.
After reading this comic, I started watching those wrestling matches.
Mm-hmm.
They sold it very well for me. So yeah, I like it. I like this comic. More, please.
you got that more. So I think we all like it then, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Enjoyable.
So it's fun fact about the comic or this issue. There's a Hot Topic variant cover for this one, and in the front it features Applejack, and she dresses in the style of Hulk Hogan. And here's another fun fact. Hulk Hogan noticed the cover.
Oh, no.
I think he even autographed it. So,
oh, yeah. That's cool.
So that's
brother.
Cool. So that's cool. That's cool. I don't know.
Did he see the page where Applejack is getting pummeled and possibly dead?
I know. I don't think he read through. I don't know. But now, this one shows the very positive side of the wrestling world, and I they didn't tell much about the other side, the heel. I think they did, but hey, this was a fun read.
You know what? I'm gonna go with the expired Applejack idea, because when the next arc is the Ponyville days.
Oh no! Stop! Don't say anything. I didn't even buy the comics yet. I don't know what's going on in them.
Uh-huh. Well, given the way Applejack behaves, I think yeah, she's been replaced by her cousin Applejake.
I thought you were gonna say Apple Jerk, although, from what I've seen on the previews, seems to be like everybody is on.
That's not a word.
On those issues.
Oh, we're gonna have some stuff to talk about there.
Yeah. Oh my gosh, I'm worried now. What are you doing with my characters, Hasbro? It's like you own them or something.
I need to bring something up when we reach that comic, because something derpy happened on the IDW app.
But now we have to say goodbye to this one and go to the next review, shouldn't we, guys?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So next week's we are going to be reviewing, oh wow, finally, after so long, an episode of the show. What are the odds? We are still reviewing those as well. We didn't just go full comics.
Yes.
And we will be reviewing episode 8 of season 5, overall episode 99, The Lost Treasure of Griffonstone, written by Amy Keating Rogers. Now, that episode is going to be an interesting talk, considering that we have an inhabitant of Griffonstone here with us.
Mm-hmm. I'm sure people only see the beak and they assume I'm a griffin. That's speciesist.
Yeah, well...
Look at my tush.
It is amazing.
It is horsey.
Stop doing that if you don't want me to take the step forward and do things to your tush.
No.
Good night, everybody.
Anyway, but we hope you guys enjoyed it. It is good to be back. We haven't done a recording in a while, and I hope that you all enjoyed the show. Even though it was a bit unfocused or anything, hey, this is like going back on the saddle. It takes a while to get used to it all over again. But we hope you guys had fun. We'll see you next time on the next MBS show reviews. This has been James Cork.
And I am Norman Sanzo.
And I'm Silver Quill, brother, cousin, twice removed.
I just realized what a wasted potential. They could have done that joke and they didn't. They didn't do it. Oh my god, that's it. Worst comic ever. 0 out of 10. Give me back my money. Ugh. Not really. Well, see you guys next time. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Adios.